morning and welcome as we gather together for Church of the Good Shepherd United Methodist Church's Sunday morning service. And as we gather wherever you might be, I welcome you. And as time goes on, and if you haven't joined us in person, you are always invited and welcome to join. But right now, as we prepare our hearts and minds, let us be in a manner of prayer. God of mystery, calm our minds and quiet our souls. Return us to that quiet center where trust resides and worries fade away. Grant us your peace that we might understand what is important and seek your kingdom. Wake us up, O God. Help us see our value in your eyes. Help us feel your care for our every need. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Keeper of our souls, you have made us stewards of your holy mysteries, caretakers of your life-giving teachings.
May we treasure your charge and cherish your words, that everything that is hidden from sight may be brought into the light.
Today, my friends are all off doing their own thing, and I just thought I'd talk to you a little bit about being in a bad mood. Sometimes things just don't go our way, and we're not in the best of moods. It happens to us, it happens to our parents, and to other friends and family, and even teachers. Everybody's human, and we're not always in a good mood. But you know what? Even if we're not in a good mood, God is always there for us. We can turn to him at any time and any place with any problem, and he wants us to do that. The Bible tells us that we're to seek him and to talk to him and share our things and our lives with him. So if you're not in the best of moods, maybe talk to God. See what he has to say. See if he just can lend a listening ear to make you feel better. I've been doing that today because I haven't been in the best of moods. I don't know why, I just haven't been. And we can turn to God, but we also have people in our lives. God has given us people that we can turn to if we're having a bad day or things aren't going our way. Our moms and dads, our grandparents, teachers, our pastor, our friends even, all those people have been put on the earth by God to help us. And we can ask them for guidance and to talk us through things. So just remember, you have people you can turn to, and you can always turn to God. Let's say a prayer to thank him. Dear God, thank you for always being there for us. Thank you for the gift of your son, Jesus, who is our best friend and who will listen to us all the time. We thank you and we praise your name. Amen. Okay, guys, I'll see you next week.
If you would like to follow along with today's reading, we read from Psalm 131. My heart is not proud, O Lord. My eyes are not haughty. I do not concern myself with great matters or things too wonderful for me. But I have stilled and quieted my soul like a weaned child with its mother. Like a weaned child is my soul within me. O Israel, put your hope in the Lord, both now and forevermore. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Before their last year of seminary, students took a much-needed two-month break from their studies. They went to Guatemala, a place known for three things: its coffee, its colorful celebration of Easter, and its language schools. The students happened to make their journey at the right time of year. They were able to experience all three things: studying Spanish, participating in the Easter celebration, and drinking a lot of great coffee. Although it was a great trip, it was far from carefree. There was a storm cloud of theological questions rolling in their heads, made more aware by the culture shock provoked by their first experience of living abroad. Everything was different to them, not only the sights and sounds and smells, but even those things that previously seemed essential to who they were. Their cultural assumptions and self-understanding and theological commitments all felt uprooted, floating out of reach. So, during a language lesson for one of the students, the internal unrest was obvious. One foot tapped nervously. Their attention faded in and out of verb paradigms, and they went through a few too many cups of fine Guatemalan coffee. The student's tutor, a nice woman who patiently endured the slings and arrows of their rough Spanish, asked what was on their mind. And since they couldn't figure out how to translate dark night of the soul into Spanish, they tried to change the questions, saying they were a little preoccupied. To this, she replied with the gently ironic equivalent of, "Really?" She could see through the question change. Taking a deep breath, the student attempted to unload the burden. Through their conversation, the tutor pulled the student's free-floating world out of the sky and rerouted it. She managed to help them see it through new eyes. The Spanish tutor was no scholar. She was a woman of moderate education and meager social status. She was not a pastor or theologian, but she had the wisdom to not offer any easy answers or cheap advice. Somehow, this humble woman was an instrument of grace, redirecting attention to God, to whom the student could entrust their uncertainty and unrest. She did not do away with the questions, she reformed them. And with that, the student found rest. Of course, this experience of spiritual unrest is hardly unique. Anyone who has spent much time traveling along the road of faith has bumped into questions that feel unanswerable, and tragedies that are devastating, and situations where God seems painfully absent. It is in these times that our trust is worn thin and our attention is drawn away to the ever-present cares of the world. In the Psalms, the prayers of the people of God are familiar with the spiritual state of things, and they look at the situation with great honesty. The following is true of the Psalms a lot of the time. Thanksgiving Psalms shout, "Hooray for God!" while the laments call out to God for assistance in ways we might find odd. Daring to ask, "Where on earth are you?" or "What is taking you so long?" In Psalm 131, there is a special prayer of humble trust that addresses us and our care-filled lives. If we are busy and distracted, instead of living in the trust and faith written in Matthew chapter 6, this prayer is meant to redirect us, guiding us back to the right path. The psalmist begins by saying in verse 1, "My heart is not proud, O Lord. My eyes are not haughty. I do not concern myself with great matters or things too wonderful for me." Sometimes we forget that there are things too great and marvelous for our understanding. And this happens easily enough. Tragedy happens and we want to know why. We look around our world and see pain and suffering, wars and unthinkable cruelty. And we find ourselves asking how those things are possible in a world created by a good God. We look to our faith and find it full of mysteries about who God is. God is one, yet God is three. Jesus Christ is fully God and fully human. And before we realize it, we are overtaken by questions that, although good and worthwhile, can trap us if allowed to become an end unto themselves. But if we are to offer a humble prayer of trust along with the psalmist, we must make a humble assessment of our ability to understand and then loosen our grasp on these questions. Only then can we redirect our attention toward God who loves us with the concrete love of a caring mother or father. The psalmist continues in verse 2, "But I have stilled and quieted my soul, like a weaned child with its mother, like a weaned child is my soul within me." Once we have undergone the hard work of quieting our souls, redirecting our look toward the God who loves us simply, we are able to be with God in peace as a weaned child and its mother. Unlike the newborn who cries in response of every need, the weaned child has learned to trust its mother's loving ability and is capable of extended, restful presence. These are the first signs of love that are not motivated by the immediate prospect of food. This is why Jesus Christ commands in Matthew chapter 6, verse 25, "Therefore I tell you, do not worry about your life, what you will eat or drink, or about your body, what you will wear." Because when we are overtaken by our cares and desires, the shrill sound of crying newborns, we cannot experience the peace and joy of being at rest with the one who loves us only as God can. In the wise words of the psalmist in verse 3, "O Israel, put your hope in the Lord both now and forevermore." Amen.
Thank you.
for today's service. And as we get ready to go our separate ways for the day and start a new week, let us be in a manner of prayer. Free from worry, we face the world unafraid. Free from worry, we rest in the promises of God. Free to love, we go forth refreshed, body and soul. Free to love, we face another week unafraid. Let us go with God's blessing. Amen.